Well, good evening and welcome to this midweek talk. I hope you're doing okay and I hope you've got your tea ready. I know I have. We're going to this evening look into the Garden of Gethsemane, that account there, but also kind of look at the same time into some of the Lord's Prayer that we hear over those words. So let's head into the garden first. Let's hear from Mark 14, this is what it says. They went into the olive grove called Gethsemane, and Jesus said, "Sit here while I go and pray." He took Peter, James, and John with him, and he became deeply troubled and distressed. He told them, "My soul is crushed with grief to the point of death. Stay here and keep watch with me." He went on a little farther and fell to the ground. He prayed that, if it was possible, the awful hour awaiting him might pass him by. "Abba, Father," he cried out, "everything is possible for you. Please take this cup of suffering away from me. Yet I want your will to be done, not mine." Then he returned and found the disciples asleep. He said to Peter, "Simon, why are you asleep? Couldn't you watch with me even 1 hour? Keep watch and pray so that you will not give in to temptation, for the spirit is willing, but the body is weak." Then Jesus left them again and prayed the same prayer as before. When he returned to them, he found them sleeping, for they couldn't keep their eyes open and they didn't know what to say. When he returned to them the third time, he said, "Go ahead and sleep, have your rest. But no, the time has come. The Son of Man is betrayed into the hands of sinners. Up. Let's be going. Look, my betrayer is here." Such a powerful passage, isn't it? So full of emotion. And it's a picture of closeness, of intimacy, as Jesus calls his Father Abba, that real picture of closeness. And yet surrounding this passage in this garden is the difficulty of what lay ahead. In verse 33 it says, Jesus became deeply troubled and distressed. In verse 34, "My soul is crushed with grief to the point of death." Jesus knew that what lay ahead would be incredibly hard. And here in this garden where he and his disciples often prayed, he turns once again to prayer, but this time it would be prayer, agonized prayer. And as we listen in to Jesus's words, we can hear something of the words of the Lord's Prayer in Jesus's prayer. He says, you know, if we think about the words of the Lord's Prayer, you know, "Don't let us yield to temptation, or keep us from being tested, or rescue us, deliver us from the evil one." We can hear those words being used by Jesus here. You know, Jesus knows that his whole life, Israel's history, has been heading towards this time. And, you know, this decisive moment that is heading, rushing towards him. The cross is hours away. The darkness is overwhelming already. And there's this agony, an anguish that comes through, that brings him to his knees. You know, Luke's gospel tells us that he prayed with such intense anguish that he sweated so profusely that his sweat was like drops of blood. And, you know, he's here in this Garden of Gethsemane, which is like a garden of the oil press. And we can see that squeezing and that pressure on Jesus. Jesus taught us to pray, "Keep us from being tested, rescue us from the evil one." But Jesus knows that he has entered into the last stage of his testing, that even as he prays that there would be another way, so to not go through this testing, heaven falls silent. And he knows that the prayer, his prayer, has received a clear no. Jesus must enter into the horror and the deep darkness that lies ahead. He must walk into the heart of this, the strongest storm ever on earth. A storm that will shake his followers, see one of them betray him, one of them deny him, and all of them run away. A storm that he will then enter alone. Jesus knows that unless he takes the full force of the storm, there'll be no way to still the storm of sin and bring us that perfect peace with God. So as Jesus prays these words, the reality is that he couldn't be delivered from this time of testing, that he couldn't be delivered from evil. But as we pray these words today, we can pray them because Jesus went through that time of testing, he confronted evil, he took it head on, and he defeated it once and for all. Jesus prayed in the garden because he was heading where no one else could go, where no one else could follow, because he was the only one who could do this, the only one who could defeat evil, defeat sin, defeat death, who could take our punishment upon himself and rise again to life with God. You know, think about the cup and the nails, the cup that he was willing to drink, the nails that he was willing to bear. What amazing love. You know, as Jesus walked away from Gethsemane that evening, as he was arrested and taken, he went holding the cup, prepared to drink it all, willing to follow his Father, follow his Father's will. And even as his prayers were answered, no, there is no other way, he grasps the cup with both hands, the poisoned cup, you could say, and he heads to drink it for you and for me. So as I come to a close, you know, the Lord's Prayer is so helpful. It shows us how much we need God, that we're nothing without him, that God is all powerful and we are weak, that he is to be hallowed, that he is holy. And because he's holy, we are sinful, that we know that it's only through the cross and resurrection that we can have a relationship with God. And yet that pattern of death and resurrection is helpful for us in our daily lives. Because as we realise that we're weak, that we're sinful, that we can't do this on our own, as we die to ourselves and our way of living, then we pray to God, you know, help us not to trust in our own strength. Help us not to try and do this our own way. Then as we think about Jesus in the garden, you know, being obedient to God's will, how much we need to pray that for that in our lives, that we would trust and rely upon him, even when he answers no or there's silence. Our need is to see that we are weak, but he is strong, that there's evil within us and all around us, and that to walk through this life, we need God's continual help. How we need to pray, you know, lead us not into temptation, lead us not into times of testing, but deliver us from the evil one. As we pray these words, you know, at the same time, it's like we inhale the victory of the cross. That's what we need to do, that Jesus defeated the evil one, and how we need Jesus and his power to overcome the evil and the evil one in our lives. You know, the same power that raised Jesus from the dead, the Holy Spirit, is the same power at work in you and me. And God continually, as we die to ourselves, wants to breathe and bring his resurrection life into our lives. You know, as you look at the two pictures in the garden of the disciples sleeping and of Jesus praying, as I close, you know, just, it was very late for these disciples. It was the middle of the night. They didn't know what to pray. They didn't know what was really going on. They didn't know the seriousness of what was about to happen. You know, Peter had said, even if all fall away, I won't. Even if I have to die with you, I won't deny you. I'm ready to go to prison and die with you. Lord, I'll lay down my life for you. And here he is, sound asleep. And Jesus says, watch and pray so that you won't fall into temptation. Those words that we would do well to have at the forefront of our minds at all times, to be alert, to be aware, to not fall asleep or trust in our own strength. But as you picture yourself in that garden, I hope you can kind of use your imagination to picture yourself there with the disciples, sitting there, you know, as they're trying to pray and then as they fall asleep. You know, when we're confused, when we're sleepy, when we're struggling, when we're failing, we can know that the disciples were like that too, that we're not alone in that. Picture yourself now with Jesus in that place where he's seeking his Father's will. Picture yourself praying by him. Well, probably better to picture him praying by you, with you, as he's now in heaven interceding for us and praying for you. But in that garden, Jesus is weeping, but he's praying for all that will come, praying for the future. You know, it's what we need. We need to trust in God that Jesus is with us, praying with us for all that lies ahead, and that we would follow the Father's will and be obedient to him. May that be our prayer. You know, may we bow the knee that Abba Father is so close to us, and yet he is also our Lord, the all-powerful, almighty God. How much we need Jesus. How much we need his power, the Holy Spirit, to keep us away from all the evil that dazzles, that looks like it's good for us, like in that Garden of Eden. They thought it was good, but it wasn't. May we not be led into temptation, but may God deliver us from evil because of all that Jesus has done for us. So those words I'm going to finish with, the Lord's Prayer. Father in heaven, may your name be kept holy. May your kingdom come soon. May your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today the food we need and forgive us our sins as we have forgiven those who sin against us. And keep us from being tested and rescue us from the evil one. For yours is the kingdom, the power and the glory forever. Amen. Let's have a short prayer as we close. Lord, may we take courage from these words. For we know we are weak. We know that we are so much like the disciples in that garden. But Lord, thank you that Jesus drank the cup, that he went through the testing, that he defeated the evil one on the cross. So that, Lord, we know now we can pray and trust you to bring your victory in our lives day by day. Lord, may we live in the light of all that you have done. And may we always watch and pray so that we wouldn't give in to temptation, but that we would live lives that honour and glorify you. Lord, keep us from being tested. Rescue us from the evil one. For yours is the kingdom, the power and the glory. Amen. Amen. Well, thank you for watching. I hope you found it helpful. And I hope it encourages us to pray. God bless.